Hello everyone. Today's topic is financing of project. So let's start with this new topic. So see now, so far what we have seen, once we have identified the project, now we need to look for funds for that particular project. So how to arrange for funds? What are the different sources of finances? How these funds can be raised, you know? Thus, there are two types of decisions which you got to make. So these decisions are financial decisions and investment decisions. You must have studied also in some another semester about these two types of decisions which you make generally, financial decisions and investment decisions. Financial decisions are relatively easy to make as compared to investment decisions, because you know there is more perfection in the market when we talk about financial decisions. While in case of investment decisions, we have got imperfections. We deal with the imperfections or the, you know, factors which create a imperfect environment. So financial decisions, most of the times, they take place in capital markets. While investment decisions, they take place in real market. Okay. So those decisions which are taking place in financial markets, those are called as your financing decisions, and mostly investment decisions. These decisions take place in your real market. So in case of financial decisions, we generally observe the value of similar financial assets. But in case of investment decisions, how do we make that decision? We estimate the value of capital projects. You know, फिर जो same type की assets हैं market में, capital market में, उनसे we can evaluate our assets value also. But that doesn't happen in case of investment decisions. There we estimate the value of capital projects. Then next thing is that there are very limited, very few opportunities in case of financing. And that have an NPV that is significantly different from zero. Very limited options will be there where, you know, you'll get NPV related somewhere near to zero. But in case of investment decisions, you get, you meet number of opportunities, or you get number of projects in which you will be getting the NPV that is significantly different from zero, right? So generally these two kinds of decisions are taken, and it depends ki we are dealing in the capital market or we are dealing with the capital projects. So now broadly, if you if we speak, you have got broadly two types of sources as far as financing is concerned. First is shareholders funds, and the other one is loan funds. Or in other words, we can say these two sources of funds are your equity funds and the debt funds. So let's look at the couple of differences between the two. What is the basic difference between the two? Equity is what? Equity is always considered as that residual income of shareholders which goes to as a source of income and wealth of the firm, right? Ki jo bhi income hoti hai, jo bhi wealth hoti hai, that goes to shareholders. Residual means whatever is left. And in case of debt, in debt generally, you know, debtors are considered as creditors, because those are the people who give us money on credit, who give us funds on credits. So these are considered as creditors or the suppliers of debt. So they have generally a fixed claim, and therefore they get the income in the form of interest and principal payment. Unka fixed period rehta hai, fixed income rehti hai, wo us regular intervals mein it keeps on going to the creditors. Then another difference which is there, equity ordinarily has indefinite life. Indefinite life means equity ka till your business is going on, your project is going on, it might be having a lifetime of five years or 10 years or 15 years. So there is indefinite life. Till your project is going on, equity would be part of that project. But in debt, generally debt has a fixed maturity date. That means ki kisi se humne 10 years ke liye hi liya hai, kisi se humne 15 years ke liya hai. So that is the lifetime of that debt. Then another thing is that equity investors always enjoy the control. Those are the owners or the controllers. All the decisions which are to be taken in the firm, those are taken by the equity shareholders. But that is not the case when we talk about the debt. They have a passive role. Passive role in the sense they are not actively involved in the management of the firm or in the controlling of the firm, right? Then dividend paid to equity shareholder is not a tax. This is a very crucial point. If we see, main difference is that whatever the equity shareholders are receiving as a income or as a dividend, that is not a tax deductible payment. Unko uske upar bhi tax payment karni padti hai. But that interest which is paid to the debt suppliers or the creditors, that is a tax deductible payment. Unko uspe tax se deduct hoke, then they are supposed to pay tax on the leftover amount, right? Then what are the key factors in determining? See, now we know that we have two avenues, equity capital and the debt capital. So on what basis we'll decide? You know, this debt equity mix, how we should go, which one we should see, which one we should pick up. The first point is cost. Cost will decide. Generally what happens, cost lenders require a lower rate of return compared to equity shareholders. Debt is cheaper but riskier source of finance, whereas equity is costlier. Everybody knows that debt is always considered cheaper because we are paying only a fixed amount of interest to the creditors. But it is more riskier. While when we talk about the equity, equity is costlier in the sense that whatever the income firm is making, whatever the revenues are generated, that is paid to the equity shareholder. Nothing is left with the firm, right? Whether it is in the form of dividends or in the form of increasing their wealth. But it is considered as safer as compared to the debt capital. The other one is nature of asset. Nature of asset in the sense ki if you look at nature of asset, so it in the project, it would decide whether we should use more debt or less of debt. So it is said that if the project has got more of tangible or it is tangible in nature, then we should go for more of debt. But if it is more of intangible, then we should go for more of equity. Intangible can be your product, brand image, or some software. So wherever things are more part is dealing with the intangible, there we should be going for equity capital rather than going for the debt capital, right? Then business risk. Obviously, risk is the one of the most, important factor which decides whether you should go for equity or you should go for debt. If you have a good risk appetite, you are a risk lover, you can always go for more of debt. But if you like to play safe, you are a risk averter, then you try to go for more of equity and less of debt. So business risk is basically what we had covered, it that it is the variability or the range, okay, between the expected and the real outcome. If this variation is more, the more risk is involved. If this variation is less risk is involved. Now there are some of the key factors, or you can say some of the standard ratios which have been determined, that what should be the debt equity ratio for a project. So generally it is said that it should be 1:1, that is equal 50-50, or 2:1, that you can always, if your equity is 50 rupees, you can always take the debt of twice of this. 2:1 means that your debt can be, you can take a 100 rupees debt if your equity is 1. So this is considered as ideal, okay? But in case of, generally we prefer that it should not go beyond 2:1, okay? But in case of capital intensive projects, capital intensive projects like power and all, even 2.33 of debt is to one capital is also considered normal, or it is considered good. Okay. Then when we talk about the control considerations, we know that equity shareholders have the control over the firm or the working of the project, but debt equities do not have. See, if capital structure depends, equity stake ke liye promoter karta hai, and the cost of projects, take an example, 10,000, and the promoters can invest only 2,000. So if they want minimum 50% stake in the equity of the project, the total equity control cannot exceed 4,000, right? Agar unko apna maintain karke rakhna hai, agar 10,000 mein se they are giving 6,000, 7,000 to debtors, their control will be, they'll be losing their control. So that means they have put a bar there ki 4,000 se zyada unko nahi wo karna hai. Hence balance 6,000 debt form is 1.5:1. So this way the ratio will come out as 1.5:1. Or if they want a minimum stake of 40% in the equity of the project, then the total equity cannot exceed 5,000. That will bring the ratio to 1:1, right? So this is how they keep a control that how much debt they have to pick up from the market. Then is market conditions. If market is buoyant in the sense it is very thriving, flourishing, you know, then equity shares can be issued at an attractive premium. The project may rely on more on equity because it is very favorable. You know that even if you are giving a good price, you are issuing the shares at a good price, then also you can more subscriptions will be there, then you can rely more on equity. If equity market is depressed, it is going low, there is a lull in the market, then you have to go for the more of debt capital, right? So when we use equity and when we use debt, in short, see, if the corporate tax rate applicable is negligible, we go for equity because there is no tax exemption in case of equity. If the tax rate applicable is high, we should go for debt. Another point is if business risk exposure is high, we should go for equity. If business risk exposure is low, we should go for debt. Dilution of control, not an important issue. Then that means we can go for more of equity. If dilution of control is an issue, then more of debt. The assets of the projects are mostly intangible. We talked about it that if more part of project is intangible in nature, then we should be relying more on equity rather than depending upon the debt. The project has more growth options, more valuable growth options than equity. And if it has very limited growth options, then we should choose the debt capital. Now, these are some of the sources of finance, how we can pick up equity, equity preference and internal accruals, and debt. We have bonds, term loans, working capital advances and miscellaneous sources. Other than that, there are some securities also, there are term loans also, right? So let's talk about public and private sources of capital. A firm can raise equity debt capital from both, right? Public institutions bhi hain jo hume provide karte hain government ke, and private banks and financial institutions bhi hain jo hume finance provide karte hain. So capital raised from public sources is in the form of securities offered to public through an offer document filed with SEBI. File spelling is also wrong here. Filed with SEBI in the sense ki hum jab capital raise karte hai public se, we have to prepare that offer document, and that has to be admitted with SEBI. Then private capitals, if they give the loan, it can be banks, financial institutions. Sometimes they just give you in the form of without any mortgage or collateral property, and sometimes they ask for the mortgage or the collateral property, and on the basis of that they provide you that. Debentures, which are privately places with a small group of sophisticated investors like PE funds, venture capitalist firms, financial institution, insurance companies, mutual funds, wealthy individuals. So what is the typical pattern of financing? First of all, when a company is formed, what do? They start issuing the shares to the first Promoters. Who are the promoters? Promoters are the people who start the company, who start the project. They are the one who own it and they bring it, initiators. And also in most cases to select group of investors. Sometimes company doesn't open it for the all public. They select the few investors and they make it open to them. Then as the company grows, it may rely on the following methods like raising equity capital, IPO कर देते हैं, seasoned offering होती है, right issues होते हैं, private placements and preferential allotment. We'll see them one by one now in detail. Other than that, the another thing was internal accruals. Internal accruals of a firm consist of depreciation, amortization and retained earnings. What is depreciation amortization? See, what is happening when every year हम लोग क्या कर रहे हैं, depreciation का provision maintain कर रहे हैं. So we are keeping some cash aside, taking it as a provision for depreciation, कि इतना amortize हो गया. But actual में तो उसमें हम कोई cash नहीं, मतलब use तो नहीं हो रहा है ना, every year. It is, we are not using it for depreciation purpose. But उस cash को हम save करते जा रहे हैं, giving it a name of provision for depreciation. And in the same way, retained earnings, that portion of equity earnings which are plowed back in the firm. कि सबको distribute करने के बाद whatever the earnings are left with the company, those are kept in the company and these are further reinvested. Plowing back is reinvesting in the company. So that part of equity retained earnings is generally 30-80% of profit after tax for financing growth. It can range from 30-80% of total earnings of the capital. Suppose cost of a machine is 10,000 and the life of machine is 5 years. There is no salvage value. That means after 5 years, there is no scrap value left. So annual depreciation charges are 2,000. Each year a depreciation of 2,000 will be shown in PLA. It is a non-cash charge, right? क्यों उसमें हम cash का कहीं involvement नहीं हो रहा है, but उसको हम एक preserve करके रख रहे हैं हर साल. तो व्हाट आर द प्रोज ऑफ इंटरनल अक्रूवल्स, व्हाट आर द बेनिफिट्स? इट इज रेडली अवेलेबल, इट इज ऑलवेज अवेलेबल विद द मैनेजमेंट, राइट? सो एंड दे डोंट हैव टू टॉक एंड दे डोंट हैव टू टेक परमिशन ऑफ द इन्वेस्टर्स और अदर लेंडर्स. दे कैन यूज इट व्हेन एंड वेयर एवर इट इज रिक्वायर्ड. देन नो डाइल्यूशन ऑफ कंट्रोल, वो इंक्रीज हो रहा है, डिक्रीज हो रहा है, उससे कंट्रोल के ऊपर देयर इज नो इफेक्ट कमिंग और देयर इज नो इंपैक्ट कमिंग अप. देन कम्स कॉन्स. What are the demerits? Opportunity cost of retained earning is high as it is equal to the cost of equity. Remember, in the sense, it is saying that dividend foregone by equity shareholders. They are saying कि आपने जब वहाँ पे उसका एक charge को maintain कर दिया profit and loss में, आपका profit decrease हो गया. So the total profit which will be left for distributing to the shareholders, it will be less. They are saying that whatever they are foregoing in the form of that, it is much more higher. कि जो the other point is that आपने जो amount उसमें limit करके रख दी है as a kind of your provision for your depreciation, but actually when your some repair or something comes up for your machinery, that amount can be much higher than the amount which you had preserved or which you had reserved, you had kept aside, right? ऐसा होता है कि actual जब हम उसको repairing ही after 3 years, after 3.5 years, 4 years, when we'll be going for the repairing of the machinery, that machinery asks for a huge investment. Suppose it asks for a 7,000 or 8,000 in the same example if we talk about, and we have kept aside only for 3 years, 2, 2, 2, that comes to 6,000. So that is sometimes higher than the actual one, and that limited amount is not enough to compensate that amount which will be used for the repairing or for the maintenance of the machinery. Then comes equity capital. Equity capital represents ownership capital. Everybody knows that. Then the shareholders collectively own the company. They enjoy the rewards and bear the risk of ownership. More the rewards, more the risk, or the vice versa, you can say. If the more risk is involved, they'll be paid heavy rewards. Now we talked about the capital. How do they issue the capital? How do they raise the capital from the public? There is authorized capital, there is issued capital, there is subscribed capital and paid up capital. What is authorized capital? Authorized capital is that capital that a company is able to issue, is capable of issuing. So authorized capital is that company, that capital which a company can potentially issue. But not necessary that if a company is authorized to issue, suppose 1 lakh shares, it will issue the full, or you can say 1 crore, it will issue the full amount. It is not necessary. So the amount offered by the company to the investor is called issue capital. Out of 1 crore, if a company issues only 80 lakhs or 70 lakhs, that would be the issue capital. Then comes your subscribed capital. Subscribed capital means that part of issued capital which has been subscribed by the investors. Then out of that subscribed capital, you know, they are supposed to, investors are supposed to pay in installments. They have paid up only 40% of the capital, they have paid up only 60%. So whatever the amount has been paid by them till then, that is your paid up capital. Okay, and sometimes it is very much possible, it's very much possible that paid up capital, your issued capital, subscribed capital and paid up capital are same. That can be the case when whatever was issued by the company, the fully it got subscribed by the investors. And when they fully subscribed for it, they have paid the full amount also. So in that case, these three can be same. Then comes rights of equity shareholders. What are the rights which they enjoy? First is right to income. Obviously, they have the right to income. They have right to control. They have preemptive right. Preemptive right in the sense that proportionally, whatever is increasing in the shares, they'll be first given that right. Suppose that shareholders maintain their proportional ownership by purchasing the additional equity shares issued by the firm. 1 lakh outstanding shares say, ten lakhs, usme se company propose karti hai ki they are sending more. They are issuing 20,000 more equity shareholders. In that case, an equity shareholder has 100 shares. The one who has 100 shares will get a right to get the, so what would be the proportion of that? 4, 0 and then it comes to 5. So 5, that means every shareholder who holds 100 shares will have an additional preemptive right that out of this 20,000 shares also 2 shares will be issued to him in advance. Okay, and then right in liquidation. Liquidation means winding up of the company when the company gets closed down. So in that case, what happens, whatever the residual claims are there on the assets after settling all the debenture holders and secured and unsecured loans and other creditors. So whatever is left or whatever the assets are left, the equity shareholders have the right over it. These are some of the advantages and disadvantages of equity capital. Equity capital is considered as a long-term source of finance. In case of insufficient cash, no need to pay dividend because they are paid only when the company is left with the profit and it has no maturity. And then what are the disadvantages? The sale of equity shareholders to outside dilutes the control. You might lose the control over your functioning of the organization. The another way is the cost associated with it is generally high. Okay, so underwriting commission, brokerage cost, other issues, expenses, these total altogether increase the cost of the equity capital. Now let's talk about preference capital. Preference capital represents a hybrid form of financing. Hybrid in the sense it is a combination of debt and equity. It enjoys some features of equity and some features of debt capital. It matches with the equity? Because preference dividend is payable only out of distributable profits, just like equity. It is not an obligatory payment. Obligate in the sense, just like debt. The debt may, we are, there is an obligation on us. We are supposed to pay it, no matter where we are making profits or losses. But on the fixed time, fixed amount is to be paid. But that is not the case with the preference dividend. And the third one is that it is also not a tax deductible payment. But some attributes which it are matching with the debentures are the dividend rate of preference capital is fixed. The rate is fixed, but the time and that is not fixed. That for sure, short you have to pay, right? So the claim of preference shareholder is prior to the claim of equity shareholders. First, they are to be paid, and then out of that residual, equity shareholders will be paid. Then preference shareholders do not normally enjoy the right to wait. Generally, it is not given to the preference shareholders, right? So these come out the same, those attributes of which are matching with equity and debt. Same here form as a part of pros and cons of preference capital. No legal obligation to pay dividends, enhances credit worthiness, and no dilution of control. Another one is it is a costly source. Skipping preference dividends adversely affect the image of the company, and voting rights are also given under certain conditions. Now what happens? For large-scale public traded firms, they consider that debentures are a viable alternative to term loans. They have the two options, either go for debentures or to go for the term loans. So just like promissory notes, debentures are instruments for raising debt finance. Debenture holders are the creditors of the company. Everybody is, so they are always treated as borrower, and they are paid interest and principal at a specified time. Why debentures are preferred than term loans? Because the flexibility is little more as compared to the term loans, right? Whether it is with respect to maturity or interest rate, security, repayment. So that flexibility is generally more in case of debentures. Then there is a trustee appointed through deed. Bank, it can be a bank or financial or any insurance insurer. The borrowing firm will fulfill the contractual obligations. Generally, you know that contract is formed, then only it is issued. Then security, debenture issues. Generally, a mortgage is there. Mortgage is your collateral security, which is put, and it has to be immovable property because it cannot be sold or bought just like that. So companies issues unsecured debentures also where there is no collateral security is taken into taken as a mortgage property. Only in secure loans they take. Then maturity depends. It can be on maturity basis. It can be short term. It can be medium term. It can be long term. If it is less than 1 year, it is considered as a short term debt. If it is between 1 to 5 years, it is a medium term. If it is more than 5 years, then it is considered as a long-term debt, right? So corporate debt of generally which are less than 1 year, these are considered as commercial papers. We call them commercial papers. Redemption. Debentures are typically redeemable in nature. They are redeemed on the maturity date. Then what are the fixed date and floating rate, which we get to hear when we talk about the debentures. Fixed date is, a rate is generally fixed in the very beginning. That on that fixed date, interest will be paid to the debenture debenture holders. Okay, and floating rate is which keeps on changing, right? Then there is embedded options. Embedded options means call and put options. Debenture might have a call option or it might have a feature of put option. In call option, they say ki anytime, certain price before maturity only they decide, and then anytime they can call it and it can be redeemed, matured. Although in put feature, they say that specified time and predetermined prices are also fixed and the time is also fixed, that at that time only it will take place. Then what are the advantages and disadvantages of debt financing? Interest on debt is tax deductible. We know that. And there is no dilution of control. Cost is generally lower. And debt servicing burden is fixed. So we already know in advance that that much is to be paid for the debt interest and principal payments. So we are prepared that even if we are not able to recover that much of income, so there is no point. We won't be able to pay our debtors. And there is a tailor-made maturity. Tailor-made in the sense, already planned and fixed maturity is there. Disadvantages, fixed interest and principal payment obligation failure to this may lead to bankruptcy. As I said, that if we are not generating enough revenues, which is able to pay the interest and principal payments, then it might lead to the bankruptcy stage. Then debt financing increases the financial leverage. You remember this CAPM model? Okay. So if more debt is involved, there is more financial leverage. The another thing is the contracts which we deal while taking up the debt. It imposes many restrictions. कि कौन सी फर्म से कौन सी फाइनेंशियल किस टाइप की बोरोइंग कर सकते हैं, उसको कैसे ऑपरेट करना पड़ेगा, उस मनी को कहाँ पे इन्वेस्ट करना पड़ेगा. दे आर नॉट अलाउड टू इन्वेस्ट दैट मनी फॉर सम अदर पर्पज. सो सम काइंड ऑफ रेस्ट्रिक्शंस आर आल्सो इम्पोज्ड. सो वी नो द मेन डिफरेंसेस बिटवीन द डिबेंचर्स एंड शेयर्स. नाउ आई नीड नॉट टू गो इन डिटेल फॉर दैट. मेथड्स ऑफ ऑफरिंग. Public offering. Public offering means that is a sale of security to the members of the public. It can be first public offering also, which is also called as initial public offering. In that, the first public offering of equity shares of a company, which is followed by a listing of its shares on the stock market. आपने एक बार initial public offering कर दी, उसके बाद आपके shares stock market में you can get them listed. You have, what are the benefits and the cost for that? You have access to a larger pool of capital. Obviously, आप जितनी ज्यादा लोगों का करोगे उतनी ज्यादा capital raise कर सकते हो. There is a respectability. Those companies which offer IPOs are considered good in the scale also and in reputation also. Then lower cost of capital as compared to private placements, and there is a liquidity. But cost can be dilution. डायलेशन ऑफ कंट्रोल. इतने लोग इतने शेयर होल्डर्स हो जाते हैं कि आप कंट्रोल नहीं रहता है किसी भी शेयर होल्डर का. देन यू हैव टू अटेम्प्ट द बोर्ड ऑफ डायरेक्टर्स विल बी डीलिंग विद इट. देन लॉस ऑफ फ्लेक्सिबिलिटी, डिस्क्लोजर्स एंड अकाउंटेबिलिटी की आपके जो रिस्ट्रिक्शंस हैं एंड यू कैन से लीगल ऑब्लिगेशन है वो बहुत बढ़ जाती है. एवरीथिंग इज टू बी डिस्क्लोज टू द पब्लिक. एवरीथिंग फॉर एवरी चेंज यू मेकिंग इन योर ऑर्गेनाइजेशन यू विल बी अकाउंटेबल. उसके लिए आपको answerable हो जाते हैं पब्लिक के लिए. एंड द पीरियोडिक कॉस्ट. पीरियोडिक कॉस्ट इन द सेंस कि जो इन सम इंटरवल्स ऑफ पीरियड्स आप ये सारी फॉर्मेलिटीज पूरी करते हो, इट इंक्रीजेज योर कॉस्ट. देन सीजनल इक्विटी ऑफरिंग. सीजनल इक्विटी ऑफरिंग इज दैट ऑफरिंग एज कंपनीज नीड मोर फाइनेंसिंग, सो दे आर लाइकली टू मेक फर्दर ट्रिप टू कैपिटल मार्केट. वंस आईपीओ वॉज डन, समटाइम्स इफ यू रिक्वायर मोर कैपिटल, देन वट डू यू डू? You go again in the capital market and you offer some other shares, another lot of shares. That is your seasonal equity offering. Bond offering, it is just like IPOs. But in bond offering, what happens? It emphasizes on the कैश फ्लो. कि कंपनी का कैश फ्लो का सिस्टम या स्टेटस क्या है, उसके बेसिस पे दे विल बी ऑफरिंग द बॉन्ड ऑफरिंग. बिकॉज बॉन्ड्स आल्सो जस्ट लाइक डिबेंचर्स, दे हैव अ फिक्स्ड इंटरेस्ट एंड प्रिंसिपल थिंग. बट इक्विटी, इन इक्विटी केस प्रोस्पेक्टस फोकसेस मोर ऑन ग्रोथ. विल कंटिन्यू टुमारो. That's all for today. In the next class, we'll be continuing.